Hey everybody, so before Rise of Skywalker was coming out, I wanted to do a weekly series talking about each episode of Star Wars that has been released to this date, leading up to the release of Rise of Skywalker. Well, as soon as the holiday season hit, life got a little bit busier, and I had some things to do, and when my Empire Strikes Back review didn't turn out the way I wanted it to, I knew that there was no way that I was going to be able to catch up. So I apologize for that failure on my part. But I still want to get through all these Star Wars movies and talk some Star Wars with you guys. So I thought since Rise of Skywalker was coming out at the end of this week, I would just do short, quickie reviews giving my thoughts and opinions on each Star Wars movie that I haven't touched upon yet. So without further ado, let's finish the journey that we started on by talking about Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back. Now, Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back is my personal favorite Star Wars movie because I feel it has everything that I love about Star Wars in it. Whereas Star Wars A New Hope was the introduction to the galaxy far, far away, I find that The Empire Strikes Back is the exploration of this galaxy far, far away. We get to go to so many different planets in this movie. We get to visit Hoth, Dagobah, and Bespin and see all these different worlds within this galaxy. I also love the character growth and relationships that happen in The Empire Strikes Back. Han and Leia start to develop a relationship, as well as Luke grows and learns more about what a Jedi is, and grows in his journey of becoming a Jedi when he goes to Dagobah to learn from Master Yoda. Which, unlike in the prequels, Yoda has a lot of personality in The Empire Strikes Back, and I love the puppetry done and the voice by Frank Oz. It's perfection. And the way that Mark Hamill acts off of Yoda in Dagobah never feels like they're on a soundstage. The environment of Dagobah feels real and it actually feels like a completely different planet. And Mark Hamill really sells playing off of Yoda. You never feel like he's talking to a puppet. In fact, at one point you forget that Yoda is a puppet and you just buy in the fact that Yoda is this creature and this being. And that's huge props to Mark Hamill as Luke Skywalker and Frank Oz, who's both puppeteering and voicing Yoda. And Yoda is just one of the most popular mythical creatures in all of film because in this movie he has so many one-liners that to this day I still quote. The Empire Strikes Back is never a dull moment to me. There's always something happening. Whether it's the battle on Hoth, Luke training, Han and Leia, C-3PO, Chewie, and R2-D2 trying to get away from the Empire the entire movie. We get introduced to a new character, Lando, played by Billy Dee Williams, and he just has charisma and charm through the roof in this movie. He is so incredibly charming and likable to watch as Lando, to the point that even when he betrays Han Solo, they're able to give the character some kind of redemption. And of course, how can I talk about the characters without mentioning Darth Vader? This is the movie that I feel really gave Darth Vader the reputation of being the greatest villain of all movies, because in this movie, he gets a lot more depth. In Star Wars A New Hope, he kind of just stands around the Death Star. You don't always get the impression that this guy is in control. He always feels like he's the henchman or at least second tier to someone, like Tarkin for example. But in this movie, it is all Darth Vader. It is all him and he does not hold back. He doesn't give any mercy. If an Imperial officer fails Darth Vader, Darth Vader just chokes him right out. It makes him way more menacing and way more frightening than he was in the first movie. But we also get a look at Darth Vader's character and a little bit more of his humanity when we find out in this movie that Luke is Darth Vader's son. We know about this because of the prequels, because we've seen Anakin Skywalker's turn into Darth Vader, but when you watch this movie alone, it still works very well. The Easter eggs and hints that they set up that Darth Vader is Luke's son are still so subtle, but when you get that great reveal at the end, still works so phenomenally well. I have often imagined being in a theater in 1980 when this movie was released and just wondering, what was the reaction like? How did this really impact everyone in that theater? Because it's still a huge pop culture moment that we talk about to this day. The Empire Strikes Back is also where you can see the success of Star Wars paying off, because this movie definitely has a much bigger budget than the first Star Wars does. And all of the practical effects and CGI effects, computer animated effects, they all blend seamlessly together and they look phenomenal still to this day. The battle on Hoth still takes my breath away, and seeing those AT-ATs versus the rebels on the ground gives the same feeling that I get when I first watched Star Wars, that the Imperial Empire is still so much bigger than the rebels and they are just relentlessly pursuing the rebels throughout this entire movie. What The Empire Strikes Back is expands on character, expands on the galaxy, expands on lore, and expands on the story. And for that, I love it. It's my favorite Star Wars movie to this day. But it hasn't always been my favorite Star Wars movie. Nope, that honor goes to Return of the Jedi, released in 1983. Return of the Jedi is the finale to the original Star Wars trilogy. It sees Luke, Han, and Leia return to take down yet another Death Star that the Empire is trying to build since their last one was blown up. Now, ironically, The Empire Strikes Back was actually my least favorite Star Wars movie when I was a kid, and my favorite one was Return of the Jedi. Why? Because Return of the Jedi had the most exciting moments into it. We first start off the movie, and Han Solo is in carbonite at Jabba's palace, and Luke C-3PO and R2-D2 and Princess Leia all think up a plan to get in there and save Han. And the battle at Jabba's palace and eventually at the Sarlacc pit is so much fun and so awesome. I've always loved the moment where Luke Skywalker pulls out that green lightsaber and he just swings it around like a bat. It always looked like so much fun, and it's so exciting and awesome to see your hero Luke go from this farm boy to now he seems like an experienced Jedi. Even to before that moment when he is entering Jabba's palace to go rescue Han Solo, he has a more stoic and powerful presence when he enters the scene. You really just get the feel that Luke Skywalker is not the same boy that he was when we found him on Tatooine back in The New Hope. And it's really cool that we get to see that on the planet of Tatooine when he comes back to save Han Solo. It's a great full circle moment, and that part is really fun. Where Return of the Jedi, though, kind of falls flat for me is definitely when we get to Endor and we meet the Ewoks. Now, we spend a long portion of the movie on the planet of Endor with the Ewoks, and it's a segment that I don't always find that interesting or that intriguing. I love the speed biker chase that we get on Endor. I really do like when the Ewoks and the Rebels are taking down the Imperial soldiers on Endor. It's got kind of a cool technology versus nature theme to it, and they do think of pretty creative ways to take down these Imperial soldiers' machines with what just nature provides. But the best part of Return of the Jedi by far is definitely the confrontation between Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader. The whole trilogy of Star Wars has been leading up to this moment, and it does not disappoint. When Luke Skywalker decides to go find Vader and confront him, because he believes that there's still good in Anakin, he's felt it, he wants to bring Anakin back to the good side. You get a really great moment between Luke and Vader where Vader kind of lets his shield down, and Anakin kind of peers his head and shows his regret and remorse, and he does not feel like he's worthy or that he could ever turn back from the life that he's chosen. I love that moment, I love that conversation, but the best part is definitely when Luke is confronted by the Emperor, and the Emperor is trying to get Luke to turn to the dark side by taunting him and trying to get into his head, to the point where he just ticks Luke Skywalker right off, and Luke is about to slice the Emperor in half until Vader stops him with his lightsaber, and an awesome fight, probably one of the best lightsaber fights in the entire trilogy of Star Wars, happens between Luke and Vader. And the reason why I said it might be one of the best is because of all the emotion and investment that I have in these two characters. They have so much history and relationship with each other now that when they're fighting and Luke is getting to the point where he's getting so angry, he's just wailing down on Vader, you can feel that kind of moment where you're like, Luke, be careful, don't turn to the dark side. You can see the Anakin inside of Luke, especially when you watch the prequels to this moment. You can see a lot of Anakin inside of Luke at this moment, to the point where he chops off Darth Vader's hand and he has him beat, and he looks at his own hand and realizes it's robotic, and he's slowly on the path that Anakin was on to become Darth Vader. It's a really poetic moment where he just takes that lightsaber and throws it, and he's made his stand that he is not going to turn to the dark side. And by doing so, he's able to redeem his father, Anakin Skywalker, because the Emperor just shoots out that lightning, and this always freaked me out as a kid when Luke got shot with that lightning. I was like, oh my goodness, that's horrifying. Vader just shoots out that lightning, and you can see Vader's conflicted at this moment. The camera's zooming into his helmet, into his face, and there's no expression on his face, there's no emotion, but you can feel it just by John Williams' masterful music and the visual story being shown by the camera work. It's a great, awesome moment. It's one of my favorite moments in film when he just turns to the Emperor and picks him up and throws him down that shaft into that reactor and blows him up. In that moment, you totally forget that Anakin killed younglings and all the bad things that Darth Vader has ever done, because the redemption of Anakin Skywalker is just so great in this movie. And when you get that moment between Vader and Luke at the very end, where Anakin is able to look on Luke with his own eyes, it's a beautiful moment. And when he takes off that helmet and Humpty Dumpty is revealed, you totally believe that that's Anakin from the prequels, burned up from Mustafar. And it's a beautiful arc to see completed. And while I'm not a huge fan at the end, with the party on Endor when the Force Ghosts pop up, that they superimpose Hayden Christensen in there, it is really nice to see him and see the redemption of Anakin come full circle and him standing right next to Obi-Wan Kenobi as a Force Ghost. And while that was the original ending of Star Wars and the end of the Star Wars trilogy, the end of the saga when it was just 6 films, in 2015 we got the continuation of Star Wars and a new kind of reboot, revamp of the franchise with Star Wars The Force Awakens, this time directed by J.J. Abrams and bringing in new cast, Daisy Ridley, John Boyega, Adam Driver, and Oscar Isaac as our new group of characters. So let's move on from the classic Star Wars into the new Star Wars and talk about The Force Awakens for a little bit. Now, The Force Awakens, when it was coming out, I remember being like the biggest promotion I've ever seen. And I just remember the hype, the intense hype and excitement that was going on during the release of The Force Awakens. And when I first saw The Force Awakens, and still to this day, I will say The Force Awakens does not disappoint. First of all, the new characters that The Force Awakens introduced, I actually really like in this first movie. Rey is very similar to Luke, but she's on this desert planet, and she also has this kind of feel like she's longing for more. But unlike Luke, she has to live on her own. She's a scavenger, so you really see that she is way more grown up than Luke ever was, and she's actually more ready to go on to this journey than Luke was in the first Star Wars movie. And Daisy Ridley's performance as Rey is really good in the first Force Awakens. I think she plays her with a lot of grit, a lot of insecurity, and a lot of unsureness of who she is as a character that makes her more likable, because as she's starting to find out more things about herself, we're learning more about her as well, and I get more intrigued in her character. As well as John Boyega as Finn, the stormtrooper that turns against the now First Order, which is basically the empire of this new Star Wars incarnation. But it's something that we've never seen before in Star Wars, and when it was first introduced in Force Awakens, I thought it was very fresh and a very cool idea to see the stormtrooper see firsthand on the battlefield what the First Order, what the bad guys were doing, and decide that he didn't want to be a part of it anymore. I thought that was a really cool idea for this character. And when he meets up with Poe for the first time and they go to escape the now new Starkiller base, or basically the new Death Star, they have an instant connection with each other, and it's one that you really get behind. As well as when he meets Rey for the first time, there's a couple bits of humor in The Force Awakens that has never been in Star Wars before, and one of those moments is when Finn meets Rey and asks if she has a boyfriend. You feel the connection between Rey and Finn right away as they meet, and when they get onto the Millennium Falcon and they go through that chase blasting the new TIE fighters, it's a lot of fun and it's really cool to watch. But my favorite character introduced into The Force Awakens by far is Kylo Ren, played by Adam Driver. This guy was such a unique villain introduced into the Star Wars galaxy because he was a Star Wars villain who was feeling pulled to be part of the light side, but he was trying so hard to be part of the dark side, which is such the opposite of what Anakin was feeling. Whereas Anakin was feeling pulled to the dark side, Kylo Ren's feeling pulled to the light side, which is a very interesting contrast and way to switch things up for this new Star Wars. The fact that he kind of like prays to Darth Vader's Force Ghost whenever he feels that pull to the light and he wants to be on the dark side was a very interesting idea I felt introduced and really made his character a lot more complex to me. I loved Kylo Ren in the first Force Awakens, but the movie doesn't just focus on new characters like Rey, Finn, Poe, and Kylo Ren. We also get some old characters in there, especially Han Solo, once again played by Harrison Ford, and it is so great to see Han Solo played by Harrison Ford in The Force Awakens. He still feels like the same character, but he feels like the character of Han Solo that would be older, that would be at this stage in his life. See him running around with Chewie again is just so much fun. It's so great to see. And when we get to the moment where Han Solo confronts Kylo Ren, who we find out is Ben Solo, Han and Leia's son, and to complete his turn to the dark side, Ben Solo kills his father. I remember tearing up in the theater when that happened, when Han Solo graces his face as he falls down into the abyss. Even though I saw the moment coming from how the movie set it up, it was still a really heartbreaking and sad moment to see and witness the death of Han Solo and to see him die as a father. Little did we know that killing off classic characters was going to be a trend in this new Star Wars, it was still really heartbreaking and kind of shocking to see it happen to Han Solo in The Force Awakens. And what I love the most about The Force Awakens is how much it feels like the classic original trilogy Star Wars. I love the practical effects, I love the use of practical suits and costumes for the aliens, I love going to all the different worlds, I love seeing the old characters again. I love the blaster fights on the ground, and I love the sort of dogfights that happen with the pilots in the air. I think it all looks great. It all feels like Star Wars, even though the movie does feel very similar to A New Hope. It's definitely not a perfect movie. Some of the humor feels a little bit more like Marvel than Star Wars to me. But The Force Awakens, I feel, is always a fun revisit. It sets up a lot of mystery for the characters and for this new world, and as a first installment of this new trilogy, I actually think it's quite good. But bringing up the mysteries and the setups that Force Awakens introduces, let's move on and talk about 2017's The Last Jedi. Man, talk about a polarizing movie. For the past 2 years, The Last Jedi has divided fans all over the internet. Those who love it, those who hate it, those who think it's okay, and those who just despise it as part of the Star Wars legacy. So where do I stand on The Last Jedi? I'm more so on the okay stand of The Last Jedi. Now, I don't hate The Last Jedi. I don't think it's very good, but I also don't think it's awful. I've always said I kind of like half of The Last Jedi. What I mean by that is everything with Luke, Rey, and Kylo in The Last Jedi, I actually don't think is that bad, and I do find pretty interesting and I like. However, when it cuts to the side plot with Finn, Rose, Poe, and all those guys trying to outrun the First Order, that's where the movie really loses me, because the plot there I just don't care about. The movie feels like it doesn't know how to use the characters in that situation. Finn and Rose are terribly handled in this movie. When they're on the casino planet trying to rescue some animals and trying to get a hacker so that they can hack into the star. It's all convoluted. It's so unnecessarily complex, and I just don't understand what their plot is and what they're trying to do in that plot. But whenever we go back to the island and we're learning more about Luke, and we're learning more about what Luke is teaching Rey and how Rey is learning and progressing in her Jedi training, that is the stuff that I really find interesting and that I like in The Last Jedi. Now that we've mentioned Rey being taught by Luke, let's talk a little bit about Luke Skywalker in The Last Jedi. I don't hate the decision to make Luke this hermit on an island. I actually think it was kind of interesting what Rian Johnson was going for. The fact that he felt like he had this legacy that was so incredibly hard to build up to that he just kind of freaked out and panicked and left everyone. I think that's a really interesting angle and lens to look at Luke Skywalker through. The problem with that is that that's what no one wants to see. Because Luke was such an optimistic and positive character in the original Star Wars trilogy, when you see him on this island, being this hermit, keeping to himself, and being a real grump, it's kind of unpleasant to see, and it's not the Luke Skywalker that you want to see after all these years. But aside from Luke on the island, I love the stuff that they do with Rey and Kylo Ren. It introduces some really cool new force abilities when they're able to communicate with each other, similar to how Luke and Leia were able to do so at the end of Empire Strikes Back, but way more advanced in The Last Jedi. And the relationship that develops with Kylo Ren and Rey, I actually think is a kind of nice and different relationship than we've ever seen in Star Wars before, especially between a protagonist and the antagonist. And I absolutely love when Yoda confronts Luke as a Force ghost to get him out of his funk, and it's classic Yoda from Empire Strikes Back, the puppet Yoda. Even though the puppet does not look as good as Empire Strikes Back, it looks a little bit too clean. It looks too much like a toy to me. In the Empire Strikes Back, the Yoda puppet was more dirty and gritty, and it felt more like a living creature. I never get that impression from Yoda in The Last Jedi, but to have a reunion between Force Ghost Yoda and Luke in The Last Jedi is still really special and is a moment that I just love in that movie. But The Last Jedi does have a lot of problems. Like I mentioned before, I do not like the side plot that happens in The Last Jedi. I feel like they were trying to go for an Empire Strikes Back thing, whereas Luke was training with Yoda, and then we would cut back to Han, Leia, Chewie, R2-D2, and C-3PO outrunning the Empire in a very similar way. We have Rey going to find Luke and learning about the Jedi, or at least Luke's views of the Jedi is now on the island, and then we cut back to Finn, Rose, and Poe and what they're dealing with. But the chase that goes on with the First Order and the Resistance in The Last Jedi is nowhere near as interesting as the chase that goes on with the Empire and Han and Leia in The Empire Strikes Back. Making it so slow and feeling like nothing's happening just makes me really bored during those segments of the film. And of course, I'm really not a big fan, like many people are, of the mystery and setup that was set up in The Force Awakens being completely diminished and thrown away. Just from a story perspective, it's very baffling that you set all this up for the trilogy, and then in the second installment in the trilogy, you say none of it matters. It takes all of the intrigue and interest of this trilogy completely away from me. It's like if in The Empire Strikes Back, instead of saying, "I'm your father," he said, "I don't know who your father is, and I don't really care who your father is. Luke, it doesn't matter who your father is. Get over it." That's how it kind of feels to me in The Last Jedi. So yeah, I'm not a big fan of The Last Jedi. I would say it's either my least favorite or my second least favorite Star Wars movie. But even with that being said, there is stuff in it that I enjoy. I can find enjoyment in the characters and the settings and even in the story, even though a lot of the story I really don't like. But who knows, maybe The Last Jedi will be looked upon fondly in the years to come after Rise of Skywalker has been released. Perhaps there's some justification that Rise of Skywalker can bring to The Last Jedi. And with that, guys, we have finished talking about all of the episodic episodes of Star Wars that have been released to this day. Not exactly in the way I had intended, but you know, life happens and I had to think of another way. But I thank you all so much for talking Star Wars with me and checking out these videos. It really does mean a lot to me, and I truly appreciate it. Looking back at all these Star Wars movies and realizing, you know what, even the worst ones, I don't necessarily hate all that much. I can find enjoyment in every single Star Wars movie. There's always some cool kind of idea that's been introduced, some kind of cool world, a cool character, a cool fight sequence. Almost all of them all look gorgeous to look at. They take you to so many different worlds and planets. And the galaxy far, far away in every single Star Wars movie, in every installment of this forever going franchise, never fails to transcend me into a different world. Because of that, I think that's what makes Star Wars such a special franchise and one that really stands out from all the rest. Anyway, guys, that's all I have to say about Star Wars today, but what do you guys think of all these Star Wars movies? Out of these remaining Star Wars episodes, which one's your favorite? Comment down below, let me know. I want to know all your thoughts and opinions about these movies. And as always, guys, thank you so much for clicking on this video and checking out my channel. I'll be back at the end of the week to talk about Star Wars Episode 9, Rise of Skywalker, after I see it this Thursday. I look forward to talking about that movie with you guys. And until that time, my name is Zachary Milne. Thank you for talking movies with me, and hope you have yourself a great day.